tell me what's really going on. Drizzy back up in this thing, I'm ready. What's happening? Gone for surgery, but now back again.
Hello. Are we here? Hi, everyone. Hi, New York. What's up? Oh, shit. I made the big time. Talk about a come up. Well, welcome to Black Coffee. We're really excited to be here. I'm excited to do another one. Portland was very successful. And yeah, the East Coast was a natural choice for the next one because I'm from the East Coast and it is way more diverse than the West Coast. So yeah, if you don't know, my name is Michelle. I'm the Chocolate Barista. I own a little website talking about being a chocolate barista. And it's been great the past 2 years of talking about these types of things, talking about race, talking about coffee. It's never easy, but over time, having the support of the coffee community and even people outside of it has been really, really awesome. So before we get started, I got to thank some people. First of all, thank you, Sprudge, Jordan, and Zach, my producers. Y'all are sick. Huge supporters of the Chocolate Barista. Oatly, shout out to y'all for sponsoring. Also, La Marzocco is helping us out. Thank y'all. We got Revelator Coffee. Thank you for coming up from Atlanta. I appreciate it. We also need to thank Oren's Coffee as well for helping us out. Ezra, our next co-host, is from there. And the charity that we are giving all of our proceeds to is the Brownsville Community Culinary Center. So they help educate and inspire people in the food industry, giving them skills to become chefs. And they also have an eatery out there as well. So you all should check that out. But yeah, let's go ahead and get started. The first person we're going to bring out, I'm going to sit. And me and him, we like to drink cold brew and dark liquor. So Ezra Baker from Oren's, come on out.
Research me, you'll find me.
Google me. That should have been Tamika's intro.
That should have been Tamika's. What's up, Ezra?
Not much. How are you?
I'm pretty good. I'm tired.
Same.
Yeah.
I'm ready to go to bed already.
What have you been doing all weekend? What are you doing with Oren's?
Well, this weekend, first we had New York Coffee Fest.
True.
One day.
Shout out.
Then I watched TV all day Saturday. Mm-hmm. And I did the same thing Sunday. And then went and met up with you guys. So, you know, pretty chill.
Nice.
But yeah, Oren's, a lot of things. Revitalizing a company that's over 35 years old,
damn,
which is weird.
So how is it kind of going in there and like being at the top of the food chain?
I mean, I don't know.
You were meant for
it. It's all right. It's whatever. I don't even think about it that way. I just like, oh, I'm at work. Okay. Yeah. I always forget that I'm, you know, people's bosses.
That's
or boss.
How long have you been in coffee?
Almost 11 years.
Wow.
Yeah, I'm old.
Have you been in New York the entire time?
Yes.
That's what's up.
Yeah. Wow. What about you? How long has it been for you?
What is it? 2018. It's been 7 years. Started out in D.C.
Ooh.
Yeah.
That's getting there. That's the memorial you like.
Am I going to be in this forever, or am I going to just go ahead and get into cannabis?
Should I go to law school?
Should I get a degree?
Maybe. Whatever.
I might go to school for anthropology.
Oh, that's right.
Yeah.
Or math.
Well, no. I started a math degree. I didn't finish the math degree.
Is it kind of math with just like letters?
I see. I like that kind of math, but it has nothing to do with coffee.
Nah.
So anthropology, I feel like being a culture person would be, it'd be nice.
Yeah.
I could do my PhD on black coffee.
There you go.
Yeah. Well.
Oh, yeah. You can get funding to just sing, you know, all around.
Yeah.
And do what you do anyway.
Goals.
But then you got to write about it, and then you got to like people like yelling at you to write about it.
No, that's
fine. I mean, do you really want that?
They're already doing that.
You already got that.
Yeah. Should we introduce the next person?
Yes.
So our next co-host is also from New York. She is a slayer in green coffee sales, Y'all really need to Google her. She has an awesome quote that will be on t-shirts soon that says, Google me, you turd. Tamika Lawrence. Hi, Tamika.
Hello.
I've been spending a lot of time with Tamika the last, like, month.
True. Check our Instagrams.
What's up? Who are you? How are you?
I'm tired. I am Tamika Lawrence, and I work in New York Coffee. I am selling green coffee. Now I'm fun employed for a whole week before I start a new adventure this Sunday. I'm tired, but I'm good. I had a good weekend.
Are you looking forward to this conversation we're about to have?
Yes.
Tamika likes to give TED Talks when she gets a microphone.
It's true. I'm a moderator, so I said last night I will not give a TED Talk.
We don't mind.
It's fine. But no, I will just be moderating the conversation. I'm excited because I think this conversation in longevity is important when we're looking at like race and coffee. My TED Talk is actually starting right now. No, I'm not gonna do that. But I am excited because I think that there is like a unique conversation to be had here, and looking at the ways in which people have to moderate themselves to maybe feel comfortable. So yeah. I'm really excited to talk about longevity for Black folks in coffee.
Yeah. So the topic of tonight's conversation, most of the people who are on stage have been in coffee for 8+ years or have been in hospitality for a really long time. So something that we all know, whether we see it or not, is that there aren't a lot of people that look like us that stick around in coffee for more than, a few years. And a lot of them get to be baristas and then don't get to do any more than that. So what are some of the ideas that you two have about why that is?
Do you want to go ahead, or do you want me to start? So actually, we were talking about this last night. I think there is something to be said about like where coffee companies are and how they spring up and who opens them, and if those people are opening them in neighborhoods where there are people of color. Generally, I don't see those people behind the bar. So if it's like this is the first coffee shop in the neighborhood, I've heard, like, for example, I live in Harlem, and a couple coffee shops are, well, now a lot of coffee shops are in our neighborhood, but when we first got started, there were certain coffee shops where it was clear that it was like, the people who live in this neighborhood are not gonna be hired here, you never see them behind the bar, and that's pretty hard, because they were the majority. And then there were other coffee shops that were intentional about hiring Black folks and other people of color, and there was a big difference in how those spaces felt and where they felt welcome. And for most of us, our entry point into coffee was barista, and it was for me. And so it's like, if at that very base level, it's not easy to get what is an entry level job, like let's just call a spade, then how easy could it be for those people to stay in long enough to get the kind of opportunities that the people on this stage have been fortunate enough to have. So I do think that there's a lot to be said about where coffee shops get opened and who feels comfortable hiring whatever kind of people. And it's like, this is all a pipeline. That's how it works. Specialty is not an industry you can just kind of jump into, because it has like a lot of really like sort of things that seem like they're not important to the outside world. But if you don't know them, you can't be successful. I think that is really sort of like lack of opportunities or barriers to entry at that entry level position make it hard for us to see Black folks sitting around in coffee.
I mean, yeah, that's pretty much it. I mean, also it's like, you know, I don't think enough people are encouraged to, like, yeah, like to do more, or they're not felt supported enough to do more. And so that kind of like, you know, they'll just like, fuck this, I'm going to law school. That's going to be the theme of the night. Fuck this, I'm going to law school. But, or whatever school. But yeah, they don't feel supported enough And, you know, most people, I think, that are in coffee, you know, have some sort of, like, formal education or whatever. And so it's, like, funny because they were like, well, you know, I'm trying to have a career in coffee, but I can't figure out the pathway to beyond the bar, but I can just go use my degree. And there's an easy or, like, a pretty much, it's not even easier, but it's, like, it should be harder, but it's actually an easier pathway to, like, a career there. So, you know, I think that's part of the problem.
Real. Well, let's introduce our next guest. Also from New York, well, but through London, we have Candace Madison. Come on out, girl. Don't touch my hair. Hi, Candace. Don't touch my soul. What's up, queen?
Hello.
Hello, sorry, I was chilling way backstage with the Armagnac and my phone.
Apologies. How are you, Candace?
I'm good.
How long have you been in the States for?
This time around, I want to say almost 4 years.
Yeah. And how long have you been working in coffee?
Since the tail end of 2009, so yeah, almost a decade.
Wow.
Yeah.
How has it been being in coffee for a decade?
It's moved through so many permutations, and even though I came through coffee really as a adult, I use that phrase like euphemistically in my case, but I started kind of late. I went through that juvenile sophomoric phase, you know, that starry-eyed, oh my God, and everything, and that associated with that. And I feel the evolution, I feel the maturity of the career, so that I enjoy. But it hasn't been easy.
Yeah, definitely. Yeah. So what has your journey looked like? Did you come in as a barista?
Yeah, and realized that I really couldn't do that. Yeah. I started in London. I don't know if you can tell by my accent that I'm not American. Mm-hmm. No,
I'm Australian.
Most people think I'm from a small town in Michigan, but actually I'm from London. Yeah. I started, I got into coffee as a yoga teacher. So I was studying Ashtanga yoga, and you had to wake up really, really early. And there was a coffee shop, one of only maybe 16 at the time in London, like specialty third wave coffee, right near to where I was doing yoga. Got really into what I was drinking because you couldn't really get that in England. Went to an ashram in India and, oh no, made a stop in Australia to try the coffee. Realized I wanted to work with coffee, and it took me a really short amount of time before I realized that I wasn't really doing anything much with the coffee that hadn't already been affected by somebody else. So I was only a barista for about a year and a half before I got my cue and became a roaster. Wow. Or became a roaster with my cue. Yeah.
So in your journey, there have been, can you say there have been a lot of ups and downs, and probably more so?
Yes.
For you and your identity.
I mean, yeah.
Because you've worked in several different countries as well.
Primarily I've worked in London and in New York, so in the UK and the US, but I've traveled a lot. I worked, I was one of the baristas for TED. So I worked TED Global Events in Edinburgh and Scotland, and then I worked TED on the West Coast here, and I've taught globally. So, yeah, but primarily I've been a barista in those two countries.
How'd you get the teaching thing?
How did I get the teaching thing? Well, unlike... teaching is a skill. Oh. No, I just say it laughingly because, like, most people think if you know enough about a subject, then automatically you should be able to teach it. That's not true. Like, education is a skill. So I come from a family of educationalists. My mom was an educational inspector for the UK government. My grandmother was an educationalist for Trinidad, blah, blah, blah. And so I got my teaching diploma from Cambridge University to teach English as a foreign language because I decided I wanted to live in Malaysia for a while, which I did. And I funded myself by teaching English. And so having gone through that diploma, through adult learning diplomas and such, I realized that it's not teaching is a vocation, it's a passion, like it's in you. Whether or not you like it, you'll find yourself teaching. Like, it's a weird thing. So the marriage came quite naturally early on when I got involved with the SCA really early on, and they were delighted to have another person in education who also knew something about coffee.
And yeah, it's like a perfect marriage for me. Like, I can't do either one full time, but both together feel natural, feel good.
So if any black baristas out there need a teacher,
yes,
there's Candace here.
And a bunch of other people, but I'm happy to help.
So our next guest we have coming all the way out from Boston, Massachusetts, and is the founder of the Boston Intersectional Coffee Collective, Christina Holly. Hi, Christina.
Hey, Michelle.
Welcome to New York.
Oh, thanks.
How's your day been?
Oh, it's been a journey. I woke up at 4 a.m. to get here, and here we are.
So where are you working right now? What are you doing up in Boston?
So I am I'm a barista by trade. I'm a shift leader at Intelligentsia in Boston. We just opened up a new shop there just about 2 months ago, and previous to that, I was working at our shop in Watertown, which is outside of Boston. So I've been with the company almost a year and a half. So
have you been working in coffee long?
I've been in coffee about 4.5 years, coffee itself. And then beyond that, grew up working in restaurants and, you know, doing serving, bartending, that sort of thing. So coffee itself was just an extension of something I'd been doing for a long time. So. Mm-hmm.
What was that transition like, going from restaurants into coffee?
I think for me it was pretty natural. I was working in restaurants primarily while I was in school, just to sort of have some extra money. But the night hours were difficult for me, especially being a musician. I was trying to get gigs and do rehearsals and that sort of thing. And me being a morning person, it kind of seemed natural to switch out of going to bed at 4 a.m. to getting up at 4 a.m. So it just kind of made sense to me, and I wanted to get to know Boston when I moved there. And so as soon as I moved there, I think I was there for 2 weeks, and I was like, I really want to work in a coffee shop. I really want to get to know the neighborhood. So that was how I ended up.
That's actually how I got into coffee. Mm-hmm. I was working on board a cruise ship in Alaska, and I had a bunch of money saved. And when I got back, I was like, I don't want to be up until 4 a.m. in a bar. I am not a morning person, still not.
No, you're not.
but I was like, I would much rather work in a... Ooh, here we go. I'd much rather work in a cafe and get out. And actually, I wasn't even supposed to be a barista, so I got hired. I was interviewing for a serving position at a cafe that closed at 5. And they were like, we really like you, but our current barista wants to be a server because they'll make more money. And I was like, do I still get out at 5? They're like, yep. I was like, I'll take it.
Yeah, it just made sense. I was tired of sticking around waiting for people to finish their food and all that crap. And, it wasn't even that good money. And I was like, oh, I could just be singing at night. I could just be doing rehearsals. I could have a life. So, coffee seemed natural to me. So
people still stick around and wait to
absolutely
finish their coffee.
To work on their 2-hour-long espresso.
Right.
Yeah, but we have our tricks when we're closing, so it's fine.
Y'all need to stop that. All of you. All right. Second to last person that we have coming out has probably come the furthest aside from me. He is the, I came pretty far. I don't live in this country.
She came from Australia.
I live in Australia. So of course, the first thing I wanted to do coming back to the U.S. was do a black event. Child, it's been a time.
The ghetto.
I stay at home. I watch You Got Served on Netflix. Just to keep the culture. I need something. But anyway, we have Winston Thomas, who's the South African barista champion, here with us. Come on out, Winston.
Thunder Beats, why did you do this?
What?
Young Star. It's the WDS.
What's up?
What's up, Michelle?
Welcome to America.
It's good to be back.
What are you doing? Why'd you come out here?
I just came to visit. I'm just passing through New York, actually. So on tomorrow, I'm heading to Carolina, North Carolina, with Lem, to spend some time with Lem and Kyle. So the coffee festival is a good excuse to stop in New York first. Yeah.
Awesome. So can you give us a little bit of a snapshot of what coffee is like in South Africa? What is it like down there, the coffee community?
Can I ask a question first? What do you guys think it's like?
You're making okay. coffee on I the think, safari, right?
Because you might, this might not be such a big surprise.
It's like Black Panther.
Black Panther, but coffee.
I was gonna come out to all the stars, but I thought I'd rather not. It's not much different. I mean, the cafe inside, every man espresso, places in Cape Town look the same. We use the same espresso machines, same grinders. Coffee usually goes out of Africa first, though, and then it comes back to us when we buy coffee. But it's more or less the same. My first trip overseas was to New York in 2014, and I'd only been working in coffee for about 4 months. So for me, everything I'd heard about before, Stumptown, Blue Bottle, all those places, we put them high up on a pedestal. And when I came for the first time, I came here with these big eyes. And it was amazing, but I'd only been working in coffee for 4 months. And since then, through competitions and stuff like that, I've got the chance to travel. And it's not much different to what it's like over here and in Europe. I'm sure if you guys come to Cape Town, you'll see. But it's more or less the same. I wouldn't say it's any different. The coffee is as good in Cape Town as you find it here in New York.
Better in some places, I'm sure.
We talked a little bit about this last week in our video call, but I had mentioned that it looked like that South Africa had a higher population of Black people who were working in coffee shops. But do you find that they're progressing any more outside of the coffee shop into other positions? Or also, like, how did you get to where you are? Because now you're like big time, globally famous barista champion.
I think it's, you'll find a lot of Black people working behind the bar, Black people, mixed race. For me, I was fortunate because of competition, I could sort of break through the mold. So I think it was a matter of me forcing my way away from the bar through competition. But you'll generally find Black people working, starting off on the bottom. So some of the guys that I started working for, I walked in, started working as a barista, but I know a lot of other Black people start off working as just mopping the floors and working as runners and working their way up. And coffee doesn't start off as something that they want to do. It doesn't start off as a passion. They just need a job, but then they quickly fall in love with it. But yeah, mainly you'll find Black people working behind bar. There's a lot of Black customers starting to buy coffee now as well. But I've only been working for 4 years. There's been a big change, but I mean, I think before I started working, things were a lot different.
Where would you hope to go in your career?
Me?
Yeah. Your hopes and dreams.
I'd like to see a lot more of Africa. I'm from Africa, and I've only been to Uganda before, but the industry is a lot different outside of South Africa, in Africa. I think South Africa is a lot more, the rest of Africa focuses on producing and green, whereas in South Africa it's the opposite. It's mainly roasting and cafes, so even the cafe scene you see is different. And I refer to myself as an African coffee professional first, and not a South African coffee professional, so I think it's important for me to learn a lot more about what happens in Africa in general. So I think that's the highest thing on my list at the moment, is just to get out to other African producing countries and see what's happening.
Yeah. All right, and for our last guest of the night, he's also a barista champion here in the U.S., our first Black barista champion. Please, everyone, welcome Lem Butler. Hi, Lem.
What's up?
You also own a roastery now, too, don't you?
Something like that.
You're doing your own thing. What are you up to?
Causing trouble in Carolina.
What are you doing
black
down
people
there?
Roasting coffee. It's unheard of.
Tell me about Black and White.
There was a moment, I think, in every barista's life where they want to open a cafe, and that kind of blueprint of what that looked like just kept growing and growing the longer I stayed in the industry. And it wasn't until, I guess it was Dublin at the WBC when I was driving around looking at cafes, and Kyle, my current business partner, and my coach from then, we would see a cafe and that we really liked, and I would say, oh man, I would do all the equipment white. And he said, nah, man, murdered out black. And then we're like, ah, black and white cafe. And that was the original concept. But after he won US and we were practicing for Seoul, one of his former professors who had started roasting and started a company on his own approached Kyle and said, do you want to buy it? And it was like the perfect time. And we kind of grew that concept of black and white cafe into black and white coffee roasters because we wanted to make our coffee approachable. We wanted to make it simple. We felt like there was a lot of pretension in the industry, and we wanted to really reach out to the customers and find out what they wanted and give that to them. So that's the whole concept, just simplicity of coffee.
So you've been in coffee for 15 years?
It's a long time.
That is a long time.
But it went by really quick.
How did that start?
I think out of necessity was, my path was music. I was in the music industry. And when that just took a wrong turn, I just got out really quick. And I just needed a job. And the first thing I saw in the newspaper, because that's what we read back in 2003, was a job for a barista. And it was early morning shifts. And then I was like, what the hell is a barista? But early morning shifts. And I was like, all right, cool. I like the morning time. So I went to the wrong cafe. And they were not hiring. And it was like super hot. Carolina summers, if you know anything about it, it's like crazy hot. And I almost went home and said, fuck this. I'm not going to work in coffee. But I was like, it was on the campus of UNC. And when I was at school, I didn't drink coffee. But I knew there was this cafe in the bookstore. I was like, well, let me go check it out. And I went and interviewed. They hired me on the spot. And that's how it started. But there was no like barista or coffee community in Chapel Hill, North Carolina, or in the Triangle. The Triangle is like Raleigh, Durham, Chapel Hill, if you don't know anything about it. It's the middle of the state. And there was no like community. Everybody was like holding on to secrets, and no one was telling anything about roasting, or there was no such thing as refractometers and scales and weighing your coffee in and out. So it was just kind of figured out yourself. There was no social media. The only thing we had was a barista magazine. We fought over it like little kids whenever we would show up. I just wanted to be out, after 6 months. I was working with, no one that looked like me. Everybody who came in the cafe did not look like me. And my professors would come in and they were like, oh, this is what you're doing with your degree. Great. You're making coffee. So it was kind of like, yeah, I'm pretty done. And then my coworker was like, hey, I'm competing in a barista competition. Come support me. And I laughed in his face. I was like, you can't be serious. Are you serious? A barista competition? And he was like, no, come on out, check it out. And I did, and I fell in love with it. It was like freaking Iron Chef for coffee. And so I just kept competing and competing. And, I grew through the cafe as like barista. They put me in charge of like training. I wrote a training manual. But still, there was no black people coming to the cafe to apply for the job. So I was the only one. And I wanted a little bit more after I became general manager. So I went over to counterculture and started bagging coffee. 2 years there doing that, still competing. My position opened up for a customer support rep, and I did that for 8 years. I got to a point where, I really wanted to be a green coffee buyer for counterculture. And we'll probably get into it later, but they did not hire me.
Into it now?
You want to get into it now?
We can get into it now.
Let's do it.
We're all on stage now.
I have to preface it because it wasn't this that kind of broke the camel's back. It was like a string of things that happened at this company that, don't get me wrong, I love the company. I still love the company. There's some great people there. But there are certain people in power at that company that kind of, didn't really believe in upper mobility in the company, although that's what was preached. So I was turned down for a management position for my department, and it was really weird how the whole thing went down. It was the two managers who interviewed me, their office was right next door to mine. You could basically talk through the wall and hear each other clearly, but they chose to interview me for this position over the phone. And I was still DJing at the time, and it was like 10 p.m., and I was loading my gear into this club, and I get a call from one of the managers, and dude must have been like high, drunk, or whatever, and he's interviewing me while I'm loading my shit into the club, and I'm like, is this an interview right now? He's like, yeah, man, I just wanted to talk you out of this position, like applying for it. I was like, it wasn't really an interview. It was just like both these guys were like talking me out of applying for the job. So I didn't get it. And fast forward to 2016, and I wanted to compete in the barista competition. And my manager was like the same guy who called me at 10 o'clock at night. He was like, well, there's this guy in New York, Corey. He wants to compete. And Corey's a great guy. You know, he's competed before. And I was like, really? But only one of us can compete, right? He was like, yeah. He never really said, I don't want you to compete or anything like that, but it was just kind of like understood. And so we had a conference call, and I came up with an option. I was like, well, let's just have like an in-house competition. It'd be too expensive to fly him down. It'd be too expensive to fly you up. I was like, you know what, Corey, you go ahead and compete. I'll figure it out. So I competed under a plastic recycling company that year, and I qualified, he didn't, and I got to nationals, and I made it to finals, and then SEA did something really weird. They came up to me and was like, so you're competing on the Verity Resins, but you still work for Counterculture, so what do you want to do? I was like, well, just put both of them down. And so when I went up and they put my picture up, they just had Counterculture coffee. I was like, oh, cool. And the same manager, he didn't come and see me compete. He didn't come to the award ceremony to see me win, and we're walking out, me and my wife, and he's coming down the escalator. He's like, oh, I guess we got to support you 100% now. I was like, wow, this dude is amazing. And right then I was like thinking, yeah, I'm done here. But a position in the green coffee buying department opened up, and I went for it. And the guy who interviewed me was, he never said anything about my skills or lack thereof. I've been to 25 farms on 3 continents. I understand the business. I've been with Counterculture for 10 years at this point. And he was like, I think you'd be bored. So we're going to give the job to someone else. So I was done. I was done. And that was everything kind of aligned at the same time. I started coaching Kyle, and then we had this opportunity pop up. So I bounced.
So what made you stay even after the first time? And even now, like, why do you continue to stay in coffee? And this, I'm kind of opening this up to everyone, because we are talking about longevity, and there's a lot of bullshit that we all endure, especially the longer we stay in it. So it's like, why are we still here?
I mean, I guess with any industry, there are angels and demons, I try to gravitate towards the good and not focus on the bad. There's a lot to learn from people in the industry, from that company. A couple of my mentors came out of that company. They're not there anymore, but so there was a lot to learn, and I wanted to basically what Dee describes as stealing that information and using it to my advantage in the industry, because I mean, it's valuable information and it's right there within grasp. And I can take that information and I can share it with people who don't have access to it. So that's why I stayed in the industry.
You're so positive. You're so wholesome. There are 2 words to describe why I stayed in the industry. Fuck you. You're not going to fucking drive me out of this shit. Fuck you. Fuck you people who pass me over because I would be bored, or I'm too overqualified, or they're looking for someone else, or I wouldn't fit, because you know how hard I am to get along with, Oh yeah. Too aggressive. Too forthright. I got forthright's English. Yeah. Too forthright, and too dominant. And I've heard all of these things, and I have stories because we all have stories. And I've thought about it before. My husband's here. He knows. I thought about it before. And every time I think about it, I'm like, I remember. So I had kind of a really fast progression through the industry. So as I said, I was a barista for about a year and a half, but I'd started roasting already. I did my queue, and I was gonna start like taking over the roasting. I'm sitting in super fancy, well-known coffee shop in waiting for an event in London. And there's a slow bar and there's an espresso bar, and I'm sitting at the slow bar. And I'm by myself, I'm just waiting. Like, you know me, I can be, I can switch it on, I can switch it off, and I'm just sitting quietly in the corner. And this very well-known roaster globally, who shall remain nameless, sat next to me and was like, okay, so we don't understand. And I'm sitting having a coffee, I'm like, understand what? What are we talking about? What's going on? I'm like, I know her. So I'm like, yeah, understand what? So wait, you were a barista, and now you want to be a roaster and get your cue? We just think you're a little cocky. And I was like, well, okay, but I don't work for you. I don't understand. But you and your whole company think I'm really cocky. She was like, yeah. And I was like, good. I'm a barista, I'm a roaster, and I have my cue. And I got the fuck out. And I stood outside, and my friend, who was amazing, I like crying angry tears. I'm like, I had to hold her back. Because like, one of us had to get hold back. It's like, no, you're a nice little white girl. Don't do that. Because that's not okay. Like, and I just thought, and you know, when that happened, when they tried to run me out of judging, when they tried to run me out, I was just like, you know, fuck you. Fuck you. Like, this, I want to do this. This is what I love. And I'm sick and tired of every industry I go into, you'll want to run me out. I'm here to stay. Have fun with that. I ain't going anywhere. So, but you nice.
Was the woman who did this to you English? Mm-hmm. Okay. No, I thought it was my Australian bully.
Oh, no.
Well, we have receipts on that.
So many. I'll be honest. I think one of the main reasons I stayed in coffee is when I first, my first like serious coffee gig was at Stumptown. And actually, even when I got started, I didn't really know what it meant. I had a really nice regular who at my shop that sold counterculture coffee was like, you really love coffee and these folks are making good coffee and you should go check it out. And I went over there and like had a really great coffee and good service. And when I left, I was like, oh, I want to work here. And that was it. Like, I didn't know anything about what Stumptown meant at that time. And this was like in late 2011. And so I think I stayed in the coffee industry in the beginning because Stumptown didn't do a lot of community engagement, the retail staff at the time. So it looks very different now. So I was just in my cafe and in the roastery with very nice people who supported me. And like, especially for the first like 3 or 4 years when the team was all ladies, it was just like, oh, you're smart. We're going to give you something. Oh, you're busting your ass. Like, I didn't have to. And in this way, I know that it's a unique experience. I didn't have to, like, beg somebody to put me on at Stumptown. I didn't have to, like, beg to get people to take me seriously. Like, someone came up to me and was like, we see that you're working really hard and you care a lot, and we'd like to extend you opportunities to learn how to manage the inventory and then into management and then, you know, other, like, opportunities like that. And I was really well supported, and I think... And I was never made to feel weird or othered, which is so unique. I know, like, I want to be clear that this is not, that I am very well aware that this is not a universal experience. And it's what buoyed me. And so, like, when I left Stumptown, I was very confident and self-assured.
and felt like I deserved the stuff that I had worked hard for there and all the good things that have come to me since. And I think a lot about whether I would stay in coffee if I had the experience that I know lots of other people have had. Like, I'm like, would I have felt comfortable? Would I have gotten those promotions that I deserved? I don't know that I feel like I would have. And so, like, I do feel that now I feel the way Candace feels. As a baby barista, if I had to do that, I might have just been like, I'll do something else that is easier. Law school. As if I could have afforded it at that time.
But you actually need to be a lawyer.
Low key, I will be in law school when I'm like 50 and tired. But yeah, so I get actually really concerned when I think how many people have different experiences to the one that I had. Because my career in coffee has really flourished, and like Candace, I've progressed pretty rapidly. And it makes me really sad to think about how hard some other black folks have it in coffee and how different. And obviously, it, since then, I've certainly dealt with my fair share of shenanigans. But I am confident enough in what I know at this stage to be like, whatever, I can just ignore these things or like manage my work environments or whatever. But there still is, and if I have to keep it all the way funky, I went to a boarding school in Hershey, Pennsylvania. So my family's from Belize. We came here to live full time when I was like 4. And then when I was 7 or 8, I went to boarding school in Pennsylvania. And so I was between Pennsylvania and New York, which is why I don't have a New York accent. And while my school was like racially mixed down the middle, Hershey is like one of the whitest places in America.
Love Hershey Park though.
It's great. but it means I feel very comfortable. I mean, as comfortable as you can feel, right? But like, I grew up with proximity to a lot of white people. I have a lot of shared cultural experience markers with white people. And so like, white people are really comfortable with me. And that definitely plays a role in like how well I get to do. 'Cause that's just a fact, right? So like, in places that have been redlined so aggressively that there are segregated, like a lot of places in the Midwest are like 100% white in these neighborhoods and 100% black in these neighborhoods. Or even in neighborhoods like the Bronx, where again, they've been like 100% people of color or not. When you are, when there's like such a big cultural divide, those people like don't get hired and they don't get opportunities. And so like, I've seen friends who like, our families live in the same borough, we have different accents. And it's taken people like Ezra and Dee to give them opportunities. And they've not worked any less hard than I have. And like, I'll hear people make comments about like their tone or they're aggressive or they're this or they're that. And I'm like, we literally just sound different. And like, I can't overstate how important I think that has been to my coffee career and why I've been successful. And I just think it's problematic because it's, you can't just accept black people in one box because that's shitty. So like the expectations, and because a lot of people here own businesses, I'm gonna say, or working or in charge of hiring or whatever, I'm gonna say it because I think it's important. When you're talking about like what's professional or what's not, or what's appropriate or what's not, a lot of that is like coded language that you've been fed literally. Like, so when you say something's not professional, why? Like 5 years ago, this wasn't professional. This grows out of my hair, like out of my head like this. And when I was younger, my parents felt the need to like put a drain cleaner on it to make it straight. And how could something that just isn't coded into my DNA be unprofessional? So anyway, I think that's one of the things that makes it so that I've stayed here this long and like I'm aware of why that's the case.
I want to tack on to that.
You tack on.
Because I agree with what you said. Yeah. But I don't know why I've stayed so long, but I know like I stay because, you know, I think I'm now in a position to make the industry look like I want it to look like. And so I'm able to work with people that look like me because I can make it happen. And what you said about accents and like professionalism. Like I feel like I literally, when I came on to where I work now, there was a woman who, like everyone else, like that was like, you know, eventually fired, but around when they were like, oh, she's terrible. She has a bad attitude. You know, she doesn't do anything. She's always late. And so I was like, well, let me meet her. I'm gonna meet her. So like, you know, we make a meeting and we like walk down and go get some ice cream and we talk. And like, I'm talking to her, I'm like, oh, you actually were running that entire store without any sort of like compensation for it because you were just a hard worker and all these bitches were mad because you were doing what they couldn't do. Oh, okay, I'm making you the manager right now. And I was, you know, you kind of see that a lot. Like, people get pushed aside because they don't talk the right way or they don't dress the right way or, you know, their eyebrows look way better than yours or, you know, anything other than that. But, you know, it literally happens all the time. But, yeah, that's why I say I want to see more people who aren't like the status quo work, you know, roasting, you know. I'm about to have a homegirl, you know, having my job soon probably because she, you know, she can do way better than me. She needs to be doing that job. And I like giving people like that the, you know, stepping stone or whatever to like reach that potential that they have that no one just gives them a chance to do.
No, I just want to say something about this because I was thinking about what you were saying about having the sort of opposite experience. And I think one of the reasons I stay in coffee is because I was one of those people who had that sort of the bad experiences early on. So when I started in coffee, I worked at a tiny little neighborhood shop that closed after I left. I left because they treated everyone terribly. But we were using a coffee, a locally roasted coffee, so I went to that. I actually ended up going to that shop. And almost immediately after I started there, you know, I could tell that I was being treated to a higher level, a higher set of expectations than everyone else. And I was having to work a lot harder to do the same things that everyone else was doing. And, you know, they would only give me closing shifts. They wouldn't let me open and try to learn how to dial in, but I was expected to make coffee perfectly, those sort of things. And after I left there and afterwards, I went to a tiny shop in Newton, which is outside of Boston. If you don't know anything about Boston, Newton is an upper class city, small city. And I was working in the most bougie part of the entire city in a tiny little shop. And these were people, I don't think I've ever met anyone as terrible as these people. And I say that in complete honesty, like really the most horrible customers I've ever had. I mean, I got sexually harassed 3 to 4 times a week. People asking, I had someone ask me if they could take me in the back room to see my piercings. I had people asking for my number. I'm in the middle of 8 drinks and that sort of thing. I had a guy get in my face asking me, yelling at me because I didn't know where the coffee was, one coffee was sourced from that didn't have the information on the bag. And throwing bags of beans at me. And these are all people who make so much money. It's not even funny. And these are things I had to deal with every day. And the worst part about it was that the people who owned the shop didn't give a shit. I had to threaten to sue them because I was getting sexually harassed and they had no sort of thing written up for it. Like, what happens? How do you escalate this? What do you do? They had nothing written up and I had to threaten to sue them so that they would do something about it. And on top of that, they were racist. So I dealt with a lot of really bad experiences really early on. This is only like year 2 of me being a barista. And it took a lot of, I think, perseverance, a lot of pent-up anger, a lot of resentment, and a lot of frustration built up, which I think a lot of I think a lot of people I know go through that, and not having anywhere to direct it. But saying, hey, I really love making this product. I really love working with this product, and I want to get better at it, but I need to get myself out of this situation, which is what I did. And, you know, working with Intelligentsia the past year or so has been, in some ways, a good outlet, because I feel like I'm being pushed in the right way and not just saying, oh, look at this pretty black girl working behind the bar, let's just put her up front. And people are actually saying, here's how you can make this coffee better. Here's how you can actually make this product better, and here's how we can help you. So I'm getting some positive experiences, but I know that's not the same experience for everyone. So I think directing anger, which is what, it's anger, directing anger in the right way. I don't know if I did it in the right way, because I ended up venting online for a really long time. That's how I met all these folks, but you know, not everyone can even do that. They can't vent online. They can't vent to their family because they don't know what you're talking about. They can't vent to their friends because none of their friends work in coffee. And they don't know any other black people who work in coffee. So I think I stay in because I want new baristas to see a face like, hey, she went through all this shit, but she's still in it. And she's still working behind the bar. That being said, I don't necessarily want to work behind the bar forever. So
I actually do want to touch on something Christina said. So a lot of times, there's this weird thing that happens when you're just not a white guy and you work in coffee, and people will try and test you and probe you to like see how much you know, see if you really like it. And even during a lab I was teaching when I worked at, because I also worked at Counterculture in the city here, I had a student come up to me and say, do you even like coffee? And I was like, excuse me, miss, do you think I get... do I get here to work at Counterculture to teach you this lab if I don't like coffee? Are you crazy? And so, like, I think there is something that what I want people to really think about. Like, at the end of the day, we stay in coffee because we really love it. And I want y'all to think about how much must I fucking love coffee? How much must I love coffee to, like, endure all of these fucking shenanigans, right? Like, and it's like, no, we don't just like coffee, and like, we don't get to do things. Mediocre black people don't get things. I don't know if you guys noticed. So like, you don't get shit if you don't love it, if you're not good at it, if you're not busting your ass, because these are things you have to do, and all while ignoring people asking you questions like, do you like coffee, and getting asked at every trade show if I'm visiting from a farm in Ethiopia. I'm like, yeah, that's why I learned this American English. Anyway, just thanks, food for thought.
Can I, Israel was saying, kind of opening up the door for other people of color. Since I've been here over this weekend, I've heard a few people talk about what coffee looks like in America. And it's something that I've never really thought about back home, what coffee looks like. But I think what's prevalent back in South Africa is kind of what coffee sounds like. Like I said, there's a lot of people of color working behind bar, but it is mainly white people buying coffee. And we don't get so many experiences, like you said. White people back home are generally open to talking to us because we are the professionals. But I think one of the problems we have is there's so many languages, and everyone's English is different. So I mixed race, and I roll my R's, and it's something that's stereotypical about mixed race people back home. And sometimes it's not appealing for employers to hear their employees speak like this. So the language always becomes a very big problem. And with some of my closer friends, the English isn't very good. So when it comes to things like education as well, it's not that they don't understand what we're trying to teach them, it's just that the English is a barrier. And I feel like there's not enough effort put into understanding how to educate, and it's, if you can't speak English properly, you gotta go, or you gotta continue cleaning dishes and stuff like that. It's a big problem. So having been here over this weekend, I've been thinking a lot about what coffee looks like back home, and it looks black and different races, but it sounds a lot different. And also what he said about sort of opening the door for other people of color, I think for me just being on the stage and getting this opportunity means that there's a voice. But I remember when I was first hired, my manager at the time was black. I was very quiet in the beginning. And one day after I left work, he stopped me and he's like, "Hey, you, your people aren't quiet. I know your people aren't quiet, right? I hired you because I know your people aren't quiet and you need to start speaking." But afterwards, he had a conversation with me and he said that the reason why he hired me, which I eventually done the same thing, I didn't hire just to get people of color to work behind the bar. I just hired to get a diverse group behind the bar so that the people walking into the store would be a lot more comfortable. Because I feel like although we focus on getting more black people working in coffee and sort of climbing up the ladder in coffee, but I feel like in terms of longevity, it's important to also have black people buying coffee and have black people feel a lot more comfortable buying coffee. Because before I started working in coffee, I felt uncomfortable going into cafes because I was intimidated. So for the most part, I think back home, we're trying to get people of color to understand coffee, to buy coffee, to come out of our suburbs, or perhaps food cafes in our suburbs, just to get a more diverse group of people buying coffee as well.
And so here we have cafes in our neighborhoods, but people still don't always feel comfortable going in for the reason that you described. So like, and to me, it's always been silly because it's like you... Okay, so I'm going to do a soft flex. I did a talk in Norway a couple weeks ago. And it was about, I did not just drop that to drop that. No, it was about specifically about why like diversity matters in terms of your financial bottom line and why actually it is really important to have, and why basically why diverse companies perform better. And this talk was like aimed at roasters, and so like yeah, about their coffee shops, or but also for their roasteries and stuff like that. But for retail businesses, that literally never made sense to me to have a staff that wasn't diverse, but especially in neighborhoods where the actual neighborhood is, because you should want everyone to spend their money in your retail business. Like you literally have a customer-facing business.
Yeah, but you know racists like to hurt themselves.
It's madness. You know, I think that's the thing that strikes me about like both out and out racism, and also I don't call it unconscious bias because I think people know sometimes that they're thinking it, even if it's not what you would call like racist. I mean, it's all racist. Let's keep it 100. But there's a difference between like KKK racist. That is like clear and easier for people to identify. And so like that's the difference, not in its impact. But I've just always been so confused by that because I'm like, actually, like racism is illogical. It causes people, and like bias also causes people to do things that defies logic and what's best for their business. So like right now we're talking about race, but like only hiring one kind of guy who has zero emotional intelligence is logically bad for your business because you're managing human resources. And like that's why everyone keeps quitting, because they don't know how to talk to human beings. And it's obvious to anybody with a set of eyes and some emotional intelligence. But it really is like people just keep doing it, and they keep like filling their companies with people that can't talk to other human beings. And the robots have not won just yet. So that's something that y'all should do something about. So, it's just like you said, it literally kills me because like this sort of prejudice actually like flies in the face of logic and like what's best for the planet, but also like what's best for a business. And so, it really just doesn't make any sense.
So for me, I guess I'll answer my own question. Why I stay in coffee?
Wait, hold on, Mish. I think we had a...
No, I thought I was going to say something, but then I didn't.
Okay, sorry. Put you on the spot.
I have something to say after Michelle. Okay. Why I stay in coffee? Well, I fell in love with it because of people. It was all the community aspect of it, especially down in D.C., why I was so excited about being a part of this. And... what we'll talk about the next black coffee in DC is that, you know, I had black managers, black coworkers, and so it very much from the beginning felt like something that I could be a part of. And even my white managers were telling me about things like competition and stuff like that. So I was like, oh, I can just go be that bitch and have like a certificate and a trophy and like be certified. But what's kept me in it, and I wonder if any of you feel the same, I guess the longer as my coffee career goes on, especially being the chocolate barista, I start to feel a pressure of making sure that I continue on in my trajectory, because I still love coffee, but it's also, I know that my representation is helping others. So I wonder if any of you feel that type of pressure as well, or sort of like,
I don't know if it's pressure. It's just like, it's just what black folks do.
Right. Yeah. It's like a very, if I eat, we all eat mentality for sure. And that drives me and like keeps me going and like wakes me up every day. And like, is why, you know, I'm still not in Australia in my bedroom with the doors closed. What did you want to say, Christina?
Well, actually, I want to comment on that. I definitely feel pressure. I mean, So I should preface this by saying, so she mentioned that I started the Boston Intersectional Coffee Collective late last year. I started it because I was feeling a lot of, I mean, if you've ever been to Boston, you probably know that it's extremely racist and segregated, very, very, very white. I know, it's extremely surprising. I mean, a lot of old money, a lot of old sort of stereotypes that had just never grown from 200 years ago. And it's really difficult to make it as a black person there, make it, whatever that means. But I mean, I could probably name on one hand how many black baristas I know in Boston, including myself. And that being said, I think that there is, so I started the International Coffee Collective because I wanted to improve relations in our, we have a pretty small coffee community, so I wanted to improve relations through anti-sexism work and anti-racism work, among other things. And so I've had a couple panel discussions that I've spoken on and I've moderated, and it's been great. But on the other side of that, I think that having this sort of face put to this name and this sort of thing that I've started, there's some pressure. Well, she's just a barista. How could she have all these thoughts? Or she's just a barista, why hasn't she moved up? But like, or why hasn't she been doing something like roasting? Or why isn't she like doing, you know, selling green coffee or things like that? But like, I think it's important to remember that I am still, I'm still black. And there's still these barriers that I face myself. And that I mean, day to day on the floor, like I'm a full-time barista and I still have to fight with my white coworkers about stupid shit. Like, oh, you didn't dial in perfectly. Oh, you didn't sweep the floor well enough. Or, oh, I heard that you, said something to this customer and we got a 1-star Yelp review because you were being too nasty. So it's like, which I wasn't, you know, I've never been nasty to a customer ever. So, on one side of it, I think that there's pressure from like the coffee community. Oh, well, she's speaking out, so she must be good, and so she must be perfect, and so she obviously is going to move up. But on the other side of it, like from my point of view, it's like, oh, I'm working really, really hard to be seen, but I'm still getting a lot of negative things from within the coffee community. And I think that's the important thing that people have to see, is like, I'm still fighting for my own career while also trying to fight for others. So. Yeah.
Where would you like to go? What would you like to do?
I think I really like pushing people. I like seeing people move up. I love management. I love like being able to help people see their vision and where they'd like to go and like their potential. Because I think, I don't know, it's almost like being a life coach in a way. I like being able to help people see their trajectory. So I don't know. I don't know if management necessarily is that direction, and like still being able to have my hand in coffee, because I also love being a barista, but there's something about coming in every day where I'm like, okay, another latte. Okay, another latte. Yeah, there's some, I could be doing more. I could be helping people more. So, yeah.
I was just gonna add to all of that by saying that I'm kind of jealous. I'm jealous that you have five people that you can count on one hand in your town, because there were not five people in my country. There was me. Because the coffee community, especially when I started, was very nascent. And so there was a lot of focus on getting people together.
That means it's getting started. The British are very fancy.
I was like, what does nascent mean? Sorry. That word was for my husband in the back. We didn't get to watch Jeopardy tonight. I will be testing you later. There was no one who looked like me in coffee. But the thing is, I didn't notice it. I did, but didn't. And I'll tell you why. I went to primary school, and it was epic. It was like the halcyon days of my life. I went to that school for 2 years because my mom pulled me out and put me into private school because all the teachers are striking in the 70s. That's how old I am. So my mom pulled me out, and it was like a rainbow. I've still got my school photo with me standing next to my boyfriend, and we were trying to hold hands when we were six. And it was like a freaking Benetton ad. Like, you know, we had people from everywhere. It was like the perfect primary school. And then, you know, my mom puts me in Catholic convent school, where there's me, and when she got old enough, my sister.
Wow.
And a bunch of white people. And then my mom still wouldn't let me go to state school, which is regular school here. She's a hard woman. So I had to go private school again we only have two schools. We have primary school, which is elementary here, and we have secondary school, which is, I guess, your middle, junior high, high school. We just have two schools. And I went to, at the time, the top-rated girls' school in Europe, so you know I was the only one for the entire time. I think, actually, the last year, a mixed race girl and an Indian girl were there. So I was actually used to the fact that everybody knew my name, whether or not I knew them or not. It's not a weird phenomenon for me, which is why.
At least you didn't get called another black person's name.
No, but I got mistaken at a very fancy do for just a random black person on the weekend. Oh my God, it's so good to see you. I love you. We haven't seen each other in so long. Stop you. I'm not the person you. No, I did. I was like, I'm going to stop you there. I don't know you. So that happens. And so when I started in coffee, it was, of course, I was the only black person. You know, of course. You know, we had, it was again like the glory days where people now have gone on to do really great things. There were so few of us, I kind of know them. So I was, you know, standing in a very white coffee shop in a very white area serving coffee with a lovely Asian guy called Sang-ho Park, who's Korean, who moved from England back to Korea and has opened three shops. It was me and him. And, you know, I knew the people, but there was no one who looked like me at all. There were no black people in coffee. And so I was used to going to SCA events because I kind of like flew myself over here. And I was used to going to SCAE at the time events. And I was used to just being in spaces where people were like, oh my God, hi, you're Candace. And I'm like, yeah, hi. And I realized that like I would just start to say hello to people like some freaking famous person because I didn't know them, but they were really excited to meet me. And then I realized the people who were really excited to meet me were black people in this country. And I couldn't figure out why. And I was like, oh, you think I'm someone. And not just that, it's a good thing. Like, you think I'm someone, you've seen me, you know people who see me. And because I started with people, again, when we were all babies, and so they've gone on to do, like, you know, great stuff. It was James Hoffman who showed me how to pull espresso. And, you know, just because I worked an account, a square mile account, you know, things like that. And so I realized that I can't leave. Because if I'm not here being a queue instructor, being an AST, you know, being on, like, I can't even count how many committees, you know, historically and currently for the SCA, flying all over the world doing something, being visible, being on the roasted, you know, editorial advisory board. If I'm not there doing this, then you're not going to see anyone doing this. And that is fucked up.
Yeah.
It's 2018, and I'm sorry, English people swear, and the higher class you are, the more you swear. So I swear a lot to seem like I'm really posh. Sorry.
She a fraud.
I'm effing blind all over this stage, and you're going to know how fancy I am. Sorry. And so, like, I was just like, it's an obligation now that not just But that's the pressure I feel, is to improve myself and to be excessively knowledgeable as I can be. Not for me. So I can teach that to people who look like me, or I can be there to ask questions to people who look like me. Everybody knows you can have my number, you can have my email. Text, don't call. I don't like calls. But if you need something or you need advice or you need someone to call, and because it was given to me by really amazing people, they constantly calling me like, oh, this job would be great for you, or oh, this is an amazing opportunity. Oh, can you please do this panel? Sure. Like, I never think I have anything to say, and then I realize I don't really have to say anything at all. I just have to be seen, so you can see that if I can do it with a nasty mouth and, you know, ridiculous hair and a strange accent, then you can do it too. Like,
but hopefully with less of the bullshit.
Yeah, you need less of this, because, you know, it's, you know, I'm a 44-year-old woman. It took almost all of these 44 years to not slap back, so...
Well,
yeah, you need way less than what I got.
What's funny is Tamika's the first black coffee professional I ever saw. Yeah. It was like 2011.
2012 and a half.
And then we never talked until 2015.
Yeah. Yeah, but he came into Sumtown, and I, because as you guys know, the Ace is insanely busy, and especially at that time was nuts. And, did you come in with James the first time?
No, I think by myself.
Okay. So then you came in twice. I remember now, because you came in once by yourself, once with James. McCarthy. But when you came in, I was like, I saw you and I was like, and I had seen you behind the bar at Grumpy, but never got to talk to you. And so when you introduced yourself to me, I remembered. And then he came back years later, right before I left. And I was like, Ezra.
Unicorns.
Yes. And it had been that long, and I still remembered him, because that's how few of us there were. Yeah. Slash. Now as much as I know baristas, black baristas are still kind of going through it, it does feel nice to see as many as I do now. In comparison to when I got started, where it was like, no, there were literally like me and Ezra.
I think I've worked with like two.
Yeah.
One being Candace.
Yeah. Right. And right. And the ones I worked with, I hired. So so yeah, that was it. So I do think I don't know. If I'm honest, the only reason any of you know who I am is because Michelle has literally forced me onto things. And, like, I would, if I never had to... I have lots to say about lots of things that are coffee-related. If I never had to deal with any of this stuff, you wouldn't know who I am. And, like, I only talk about, like, I do this as, like, a side gig on top of doing my actual job that people pay me for. And so I'm hoping that, like, the baristas who see me do what I do now, or, like, people who are roasters or whatever, 5 years from now are not having to do this. And, like, hopefully they don't know who the hell I am, because then it means that, like, things will have changed at that point.
I'm so sick of talking about race, guys. I'm sick of it.
Me too.
I just want to do my damn job. I want to talk about coffee. I want to talk about all the stuff I know about coffee, because for God's sake, I've been doing it for 10 years and people just want to know about what it's like to be black in coffee. And I'm telling you, you will never see an all-white panel just talking about the race that they are in the industry that they're doing, because what the hell is that? The next time we do this, can we just talk about coffee, please? Do you know what I mean? Like, that's the world I want to live in. Like, I do know stuff about coffee that's not about being black in coffee. You know that, right? I know all about green coffee and shit. It's awesome. Like, you know. Right, anyway, sorry. Yes.
I won't ask you next
time. I'm not going to lie. I love sassing people. So, like, I mean, I would like to sass y'all about something else, but I'll talk about it until it's, like, not a problem anymore. Right. But I see what you mean. Like, this weekend I got to give a different talk that was about, like, a sourcing program that my old employer had. And I was like, this is great. Because I'm, like, giving a talk about a coffee thing, and I know lots of coffee things. Yeah, so that was good.
What's funny is, like, a few, you guys know about it because, you know, group text. But what's funny is, like, I was online and I saw like the story for this conference, and they had like a diversity panel, and it was all white people. And so I like get my fingers together and I type a little message because this event, I actually like this event. So I was like, hey, it's like y'all didn't try to get any, you know, people of color to talk on this board or anything. And they were like, oh, you know, we would love to have Michelle, but, you know, we couldn't get her. And then I go,
but she's a single coffee black and she was unavailable.
But wait, but then I go, I was like, Michelle always has to do stuff. You're going to put her through all this emotional, like, labor to always talk about the same damn thing again. And I was like, can't y'all get somebody else? And don't say to me, but it's like, you know, people, it's like so funny. It's like there are, you know, at least 20, 30, 40 people that, you know, y'all can choose from, but like somebody, y'all choose the same five crayons every time. And it's just lazy. Just do a little bit of more work. Well, or you can ask the people you want to ask recommendations, you know?
But also, if you have to look that hard, you're like not doing it right. Because it's like these people are not in your network. Like if you don't know anybody or you don't know anybody that knows someone personally, that's like, I mean, that's red flag number one. And it's good to recognize, because I do get this a lot where people are like, so we know we're doing this and I know this is an issue. And then they say something else and I'm like, so here's the thing. The first thing you do is that you say that you know there's an issue, and then the second part is doing something.
Yeah.
So try that next time. So like actually, you know, create diversity initiatives in your company so that you don't have to call the three coffee blacks that you know, to ask them to do a thing. You could hire a coffee black. That is a thing you're allowed to do.
I will say that the event listened and they're like, okay, that's a good point, and we're going to do that next time.
And there are people, and like as much as we are ribbing people, like one of the reasons I've stayed in coffee actually is that like coffee has shown the capacity to listen. Like, for real. Like, it's not perfect. But, like, one of the reasons I do stay in our industry, and I actually have a couple non-coffee friends here who are like, you really love, in a different group chat, who are like, you really seem to love your industry and, like, working in it, and you really enjoy your work. And it's true. Like, I do think coffee is really special. And, like, even though it doesn't look the way it could yet, I still think the people who are in it are mostly really good. And that's why I say something. Because if I thought I couldn't, like, I am very big about not wasting my energy. So I thought if you guys couldn't hear me, I would be like, I'm going to do something else. And so, like, sometimes it feels a little harsh, but we do it because we think well of our industry and because we think well of the people who work in it and because we love it. And so I just think that's something to think about. But Christina, you were saying something.
No, I was just thinking about when me and Ezra did the wind down, and the reason that even, so when Bloom happened in Providence a few months ago, I happened to be looking over all the talks online, and I was like, well, it's all white people talking. And I was like, wow, this is bullshit. And I was like, you know what would be really funny is if I came down there and had a party for only black people. And then Ezra was like, we should actually do that. And so that was how the wind down actually happened, is I was like, let's have like a wine party at like nearby and invite only the black people to it. And that was like my original idea for it. It didn't turn out that way. But, you know, it was just to see it happen over and over and over again, and then call someone out and be like, hey, how come there was only like white people talking at this really, really big like trade show? And they're like, oh yeah, do you want to come and talk at it? Like as if that's gonna fix the situation. Like asking me or asking Tamika or asking Michelle to come talk at something because they forgot is not remedying the situation. That's just lazy.
And it also doesn't feel nice.
No, it doesn't feel good.
Like, we don't want to. I would much prefer, again, I know so many things about coffee, y'all, I swear. And I would prefer to be talking about that. So, like, I guess another thing I would love for people to think about is, like, When someone is telling you something like that, I really want you to think about how much courage it takes to say something that you know isn't going to be well received, or that there's a possibility that it might not be well received, or that it has the capacity to hurt someone's feelings. And also, you know that that person's, that both society and that person is going to place their hurt feelings above your actual lived reality, and that's the worst. So, like, when someone is saying something like that to you, it is not because they want to. We, too, want everyone to like us, so they, like, offer us jobs and ask us to do things. And so if we're in the position of telling people uncomfortable things, it sucks, and it's not really fair. And then if we're doing it, people should really think, like, oh, and that's that thing about emotional intelligence and, like, really being able to put yourself in somebody's shoes and really saying, what did it cost that person to make what is a vulnerable they put themselves in a vulnerable position to tell me something that they know maybe wouldn't be well received.
Well, we were talking about this during we had a phone conversation last week, and we were talking about censorship and how much I'm doing it right now. I've been doing it since we started censoring myself about things that I want to say that potentially be hurtful to my own job.
You can't say fuck that. You see what I'm saying? It's very, when you're the chocolate barista, you work for yourself. Yeah. You can say fuck that.
I'm not talking, and I'm not talking about like censorship, like saying fuck or shit or like that. I'm talking about like saying something that could potentially hurt my career or like hurt someone else's career or like calling people out by name, because I could call people out all day, but if I don't say the name, how much does it really mean? I think that Black people in particular do that more than anyone, and because mainly because of anger, and retaliation. Retaliation about like what could happen if I say, oh, I didn't really like the way that you just spoke to me, and then like 2 days later, you hear it from 8 different people about how you said how I was too emotional, blah 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 blah. Oh my God! The other day,
also human beings are emotional, right. And that's fine. And also, right. Anger is an emotion. So when y'all are yelling in meetings and you think that that's not emotion, that is also an emotion. Sorry, I just had to.
No, it's okay. The other day, my coworker, you know, we have a not strict dress code, but a little bit of a nicer dress code at the shop I work at. And one of the girls at my shop, she doesn't seem to get it. And I've told her before, please don't wear this, please don't wear this. She came in another day wearing something that was just, it was inappropriate for the dress code. And so, you know, I was a little bit upset. And the other shift leader, a white guy, I told him, I was like, I think I'm going to have to write her up this time. And he was like, you're getting too upset. You're getting too emotional about this. You need to just let it go. And I was like, I'm sorry. I'm just doing my job. Literally, I told her twice not to do this. She came in a third time and did it. It is my job to do something about it. Don't tell me I'm being too emotional. You know? And these are the types of things. And if I don't do anything, then I'm being a bad shift leader. Then I'm not doing my job to enforce the rules and enforce the standards that we have that I feel are like completely reasonable. I wasn't telling her she looked like, you know, looked bad. I was telling her she didn't look appropriate for what our standards are. And to be told that I'm being too emotional because I'm doing my job is garbage. And I'm not okay with it. And I hear it so often. From this one particular person, but I hear it so often by making decisions that are, I think, very objective, for some reason in my lens, look way over the top. And I can't understand that. But.
No, it's true. And the self-censorship is exhausting. I've been doing it as I have, it's not even a conscious thing. You do it and you leave the house. You do it at work all the time, every day. You look at people with envy and jealousy, but because of the color of their skin, can get away with being honest, can get away with being truthful, can get away with being vulnerable, can get away with being emotional. And you have to hold yourself to a standard that makes you tired. We got tired, and roasting was awesome. Because you know what? I don't have to talk to anyone. Like, literally, it was me, the green coffee, and the roaster. and I could be tired and I could yell at it and I could just be myself and do my job and not have to think. And that extra emotional and kind of like mental work that you do every day is exhausting. It's a form of abuse. And so I don't come from this society. And England and America are very different. We don't talk about race in England, because even to talk about race in England means that you're being divisive. And why are you causing trouble? And why are you stirring things up? You talked a little bit about language. I code switch really easily because I'm middle upper class English or upper middle, whatever you want to say. So I talk a certain way because that's the way I was taught to talk in public, at school, what have you. In my house, we talk fairly similarly, but my parents are both West Indian, so blah, blah. With y'all, I talk differently than I would with another set of baristas. And that's just the work that has to be done. But what's really insidious and what I see when we're talking about language and the way you present yourself, what's really messed up is that in this country, my accent is currency. However, I can't rest on that, because if I say the wrong thing here, if I look too strident, if I look too confident, if I look all of the things that you would think an employer would want, a confident, well-spoken, well-educated, knowledgeable person who gets along with people, I can't be too many of those things. I was fired from my first barista job for being too friendly. I'm not joking. And I don't mean inappropriately friendly. I didn't get anyone's phone number. I wasn't hanging out drinking. I mean, the fact of the matter was that everybody thought that I owned that shop because I'm an actress, so I'm very natural with people. The person who owned the shop was very shy, but really wanted to be a coffee man. You know, it was his thing, and it was his shop, and he'd come from Australia, and he had learned, and he was in coffee. And he fired me because he told me this. He got sick of people asking him when he started working for me. I was just taking money at the goddamn register. You know, but it was the fact that the coffee shop was near a very famous hospital in London, and I was serving very well-known surgeons, and I was getting a lot. And so these are the things that, the extra layer of things that you have to think about, and the extra layer that you have to suppress. Like, I'm exhausted. And I can, the race dynamic here is so different. It's so much, it's so incendiary. It feels that way to me. And for the first time in my life, I was scared for my life. I think it was about 2 or 3 years ago when there were a lot of these police murders. I was outside a coffee shop in Washington Square, and there are a bunch of police, and we don't have armed police in the UK. There are a bunch of police around, excuse me, and I realized that unlike England, where I might get hassled maybe by a police officer, in London it's, depending on where you are and where I live, it's not like that. Here I could be in fear for my life, my freedom, my safety, and I couldn't count on anyone to have my back. However, looking at in this audience, I see so many people I know and love who have supported me in New York Coffee. I see a man in the audience who I won't name check because it's rude and I haven't told him this, who saw the way I got treated at a company I worked for, who saw the way they terminated me for doing my job too effectively, and he quit the next day, citing that reason in his resignation letter. I have never had a white person stand up for me like that before. And he's not rich, and he doesn't have, you know, a next step, but he was like, you know what, it's enough. I can't watch you, knowing who you are, knowing what you've done, knowing your experience, be treated like that. And that's the first time someone saw me as a coffee professional in that respect, and not like a black person who may be causing trouble by just being there and circumstances hanging around. So, high five. You know who you are. I love you.
I do. I'm finally going to moderate instead of giving mini TED Talks. I would like to circle back to that, to the idea of the censorship from our light-skinned brothers at the end of this row. What do y'all think? Sorry. Sorry, y'all. I'm actually like a troll.
What? What'd you say?
I said from our light-skinned brothers at the end of this.
Oh, other light-skinned brothers. You want to talk about censorship?
I'm just a troll. But I do want to talk. I do want to talk about the ways that you feel like, or ask you, are there ways in which you feel like you've had to censor yourself to, like, either to stay in the industry, like, for longevity, to keep working, be able to work at a company, moving up? Because I do think, to me, that's one of the main things that I feel like we've all had. I have had to, and I think it's, like you said, for Black people, it's kind of second nature. So, like, what are some ways that y'all have had to do that, or do you feel like you've had to?
Can I?
Go ahead.
I think it's close to what you said earlier. You said you hated having to hear about the racing coffee. And I think back home when I started working, I just adopted the mindset of just looking forward. So people of color do have to work harder than white people back home. And that's a fact. I think the opportunity is there for both races to start in a certain position, but there's always going to be there's going to be a bit more opportunity for somebody that's white, but I felt like it was something that I couldn't dwell on in the beginning. And I remember I had some guys sit me down and they asked me why I'm here, because I studied engineering. And I said, I'm here because I like coffee. They said that they'd never seen anyone pack tea the way I packed tea before, and why do I enjoy it so much? They asked me, do you want to enter competitions and stuff like that, and when do you expect to win? And I told them, and I feel like if I dwelled on the race thing, which a lot of people I know did dwell on, I don't think I would have gotten as far as I did. And I think getting in this position, like Ezra said, we kind of need to open up the door. Because I think back home, a lot of people, their success is measured in coffee. So, I mean, they start off working in coffee to be a barista, and their form of success is learning how to pour latte art and learning to do a certain design, which is perfectly fine. But I feel like you need to have goals further than that. And I think because a lot of people have been so suppressed, they just don't think further than that. So I think for all of us, just being on the stage, it means that we're in a certain position of influence. And it's important that we use that influence in the right way so that, I don't know, the next South African barista buys a ticket to New York Coffee Festival next year and just shows up, or I get invited again next year or something like that. Or I think I'll give a shout to my friend Remy, who just won Coffee Masters. I mean, I'm not sure if anyone from Costa Rica has entered before, but I know with Remy winning now, obviously it opens up the door to so many more Costa Rican baristas. And I think just for me back home, if I dwelled on race, I don't think I would have gotten the same momentum that I have right now.
Do you think that there are ways that you have to? Because the fact is, it's tricky, right? When you say dwell on race, it's like, but you are a person that is not a white person. That's like a part of your reality. It colors the way in which you move through the world. And do you feel like you get to be your full self?
I think I've been in a privileged situation where I haven't had to deal with certain things that you've had to deal with.
Yeah.
So I don't think I've censored myself, but I haven't been in a position where I've had to speak out because I haven't had those things happen to me.
Yeah.
But I do think I can say it's because my success with competition happened so early on. I sort of got that push, whereas I know there's a lot of people. But I think the biggest thing back home is that we speak about it amongst ourselves, and there's no platforms like this to kind of express what it is we feel.
Right.
And we all know how things are, but nobody's really talking about it.
Yeah.
So I think you might say I'm nice, like him as well. But like I said, I think it's just the mindset that I adopted in a very privileged position as well.
What about you, Lemuel?
I became the master of censorship at an early age. In such a way, I made myself invisible.
Yeah.
My family, my dad's family is from North Carolina. My mom's family is from Boston. And my parents met in Boston, so I was born in Boston. And at an early age, we moved back to North Carolina because Boston's jacked up. But a kid, light-skinned, moving in a low-income neighborhood with everyone dark-skinned, and they hate white people,
I had I mean, at that time, yeah. Let's face it, they had some reasons.
Yeah.
I had an afro. Talking about post-Jim Crow South.
And a very strong Boston accent, which I lost. Thank God. No offense if anyone's from Boston. But so I got beat up a lot. And I was very, you know, kids approached me and, you know, I wouldn't back down. But there was this one big kid, he really wanted to get into it. I ran home, ran into the house. My dad was like, and my dad, he never went to college. He was the smartest, richest black man I ever knew growing up, and he had no money. But running in the house, he was like, what's your problem? It's like, this dude wants to beat me up. He's like, well, go fight him. He's like, he's bigger than me. He's like, listen, your country has abandoned you. Your road to in life is going to be more difficult than anyone else. Remember that someone else is going to have it harder than you. And if you see them along the way, pick them up. Now go out there and get your ass beat. Never understood what he meant, but I went out there and I got my ass beat. And at that moment, I never talked back to any of the kids in the neighborhood. And so, you know, I just went through an early age of like just making myself small and trying to figure out the situation. But I had an escape because, you know, that shit gets frustrating. You know, you get, there's pressure in that and you get stressed out and you need a release. So I started tagging buildings with Krylon, you know? And then when I got to high school, it was music. That was my escape. And then later on in life, it was coffee. So, and in coffee, you know, as I got outside of the box and saw where coffee came from and saw farmers who were dedicated to something that was bigger than themselves, and they had it way harder than I did, you know? So it meant something. And just making myself small and trying to figure it all out, I did well in a competition, but that young kid started to come out, and then, you know, judges started to say, okay, you need to chill out. You're getting too personal, you're too laid back. But I'm like, that's what you want in a competition. I'm not gonna censor myself in a competition because I love this. I love this. I love how these baristas from around the country are coming together and they're helping each other backstage. This was a community that I never had and that I wanted to, you know, be a part of. So I started not censoring myself in certain ways and just trying to find tricky ways to put myself into the competition. It took 10 years because they didn't like me. Just sticking to my guns, I managed to do that. And as I traveled, I would see folks and be like, yeah, I watched your competition, I watched your presentation, and it was so smooth. You're really, you know, engaged with the judges. I really love that. That's very inspiring. I'm like, word, I'm glad I didn't, you know, censor myself, you know? I think I became a chameleon through life, trying to make myself invisible to figure it out, not to step on any toes and get beat up.
And I do think actually, so I don't, we're not going to spend a lot of time on competition or anything, but you did bring up a really good point that kind of ties back to something we were talking about earlier, which is that, like, how could you be dinged in a competition for being comfortable? And like, when you, as someone that has judged a bunch of competitions of all kinds, whenever there are like marks for professionalism, when people are talking about professionalism, they have like one kind of person in mind that makes a professional person. And all of those things are literally drawn from just like, I mean, there's no other way to say it. They're just like, it's just like a white supremacist professional ideal. You can't say anything else because it's just like, that's what it means for this person to be professional and everyone else is being judged against this standard of professionalism instead of being like, where do these ideas of professionalism come from? And like, do they actually mean anything? Or am I just comparing everyone to a white guy?
Yeah, I mean, that's the kind of stuff that was upsetting me, you know? And I was like, well, I'm just going to be in your face now, all the time. Because, you know, standing on stage in front of people that don't look like you, who are judging you, judging your skills, that's some difficult stuff to handle, you know? And I'm not gonna change who I am because I don't fit the image that you're looking for to represent the United States, and especially industry. I'm gonna change your mind of what that looks like.
Yeah, and why is that more, it's just not more professional, it's not more effective, like those, like the ideas and those standards and where that stuff is coming from, it's just like, it's kind of just racist. And I'm never, it doesn't matter how hard I work, I'm never not gonna be a black person. So it's like, people do really need to challenge themselves. And like, if you are in a position to hire or like set up a company culture, you need to interrogate yourself more than like anybody else on staff, because you have to think like, where does this stuff coming from? Am I subconsciously creating a culture where the only kind of people who can succeed here look like this? And take a survey of your staff, see who's getting paid what, see who stays for how long, see who gets promotions. Because I mean, your feelings are one thing, but like the way your company looks is a statistical reality.
Yeah. I feel like some like customer service styles, like a lot of people don't think about, they're like, have a lot of, yeah, you're absolutely right. They do have a lot of like, I'm gonna say it, like slave times.
100%.
Or like right after Reformation times, you know, kind of attachment to it. And like, you know, I know personally, I've you know, seen those tactics, and I'm like, no, I'm not doing that.
Well, people just have different expectations.
Oh yeah.
It's just, I'm really sorry, I have to jump in here, because the happy Negro thing really fucks me off. Like, I'm not always happy, but guess what? I'm always damn professional.
Yes.
And you know what? The thing where that person is leaning gently, you know, on their back bar and listening to tunes and, you know, acknowledges you gently when you walk in is either really mysterious and captivating, or they're very cool if they're one type of person. And it's just rude and unprofessional if it's another type of person. As Christine is, I've never given anyone bad customer service, but I can guarantee you that I will have received bad customer service reviews more than someone who actually has given bad customer service. But yeah, homie, don't play that. I'm not smiling because you need to see me dance. Yeah.
That's also funny with places that have the like costumes.
Yes.
And I'm like, ooh, that time was not a good time for us to be dressing like. So why do you want me to dress like that? Sorry to put you on blast, Tamika.
Troll.
I was actually talking with a coworker about this the other day. I've got a new shift leader. He's young and he's learning about, you know, becoming more focused and everything like that. And so I coach him a lot, and I'm not always I can sometimes be blunt. And he sent me a message and he said, well, you know, I really appreciate all the coaching and the feedback you give me. He's like, you know, I know I can be emotional. And he's like, I'm just trying to take it all in. And, you know, I thought about it a lot and I was like, you know, I know that I can be blunt. I know that I can be maybe sometimes too honest. But I think where that came from for me is wanting to be taken seriously, and wanting to be heard and not basing it on what you're seeing and where it's like, where you're hearing it from. And so I think sometimes I can be frank. And I hear a lot of people doing that, being black people specifically, when they start to get into higher positions, they sometimes have a hardness about them that I don't think is that they're a hard person. I think it's that they are trying to be as even keeled as possible, because if they put on any sort of emotion, it's taken as being either playing favorites or picking on someone. Oh, I get that a lot. People, you're picking on me because I keep messing up. And I'm like, no, I'm telling you that you're messing up and that you need to do it better. Like,
and that's such a good point, because a lot of people, so the people who really know me know I'm like kind of a fool. Like, I'm so silly. I'm actually the silliest person I know.
True.
And some people who, I just am, it's a fact. And the people who only know me professionally sometimes don't know that about me. So, like, honest, if I have to be honest about, like, the censorship that I do, I feel like what's the most sad is that people don't get to see, like, the best parts, what I consider to be the best parts of me until after they've known me for a long time, because I have to mask those things to be taken seriously. And then I also find myself sometimes in environments where I'm having to be harder than I would like to be naturally. So, like, yeah, I'm very frank, and I've always been that way, and that is never going to change. But I think my preference is to communicate. I'm a good communicator, and I'm a kind communicator. And, like, my preference is to do that and make somebody laugh and deliver a truth that maybe is not easy to hear. But I find myself having to be harder than I am inclined to be, specifically because I know that's what the people in charge respect. So, like, the people in charge respect a certain kind of person, and it's easy for me to emulate this certain kind of person, and so I'll do it because I have to, but I don't view it as the ideal mode of communication, and I would prefer it not to be that way. And I don't actually think that's just racist, I guess racism that causes it. It's also just, like, it's also patriarchal.
Yeah, sexism, too.
Yeah.
Because I feel like I have to do it because I'm black and a woman.
Yeah.
Like, seriously, I mean, I hear men saying the same things that I'm saying. Like, literally, they just repeated the shit that I just said, and they're like, oh, yeah. Yeah, that makes total sense. And I'm like, I literally just said that.
Yeah, and so in meetings...
Just said that.
Yeah, and so in meetings, there are definitely times when I've had to... be aggressive and say, no, you can't, or, you know, or, like, when someone tries to talk over me, so people try to talk over me, and instead of, like, just saying, letting them go or do whatever, I'm like, wow, this person's just going to do it forever. And so then I have to, like, then I have to get mean so that they know not to do it again. But it's like, this is not, that's, like, damaging to me. I don't want to do that. That's actually not my style, and it's not the person that I am. And so then I find myself being thought of as, like, really effective and very respected. But I'm like, I am effective and respected and could be those things not having to be this way at all. If you could hear me, if you could not take advantage of me unless I was, like, keeping a, like, tabs on you every second. Like, if I could just trust you to respect me, I could do it this way, like, my way. And so I do think, to me, that's one of, like, and there is something now as I get closer to 30, I'm actually just unwilling to do it. And if I can't be me in an environment, to a degree, because, again, you know, gotta pay my bills, feed my dog. So if I can't be me in an environment, and if I can't be heard or respected the first time I say something, then I do just, like, I'm like, okay, this is not the place for me, and that's fine. Because I don't, like Lem said, I don't want to censor myself anymore. And I also feel like some of the best things have come to me because I won't do it. But I don't think, but if I'd started out that way, that wouldn't be the case.
So those two actually tied in, pressure and censorship. Because you feel the pressure to censor yourself because you gotta feed your family. I mean, I didn't feel any pressure until I started growing a family, you know? So at a company that has some internal issues, choosing not to speak out about that preserved my family's, you know, lifestyle. You know, being able to feed, I mean,
so you had to stick it out.
Yeah.
Yeah.
I mean.
Yeah, totally. I get that. Like, I support family back home, and it's definitely at the forefront of my mind.
So you sacrifice a nice salary, 401k, health insurance, because you're upset about something, you know? Or, I mean, how far do you let it go?
And I just want you all to, everybody in this room, to have a word with yourselves, have a check-in with yourselves. Like, if you're not a person of color and you're sitting in this room, this can sound like grievance or complaining Or, well, if you do that, of course that's going to happen. Or you have to be professional. What are you talking about? Like, just think, like, just for me, just for one moment, think about the fact that you could put on your best suit and tie, or you could put on your best dress, and you could go for a job interview, and that person will hear you, and that person will see you, and I can do the exact same thing with the exact same script, and it's not the same. That person won't see me. Or there's a chance, there's a significant chance that that person won't see me. And there's a significant chance that that person won't hear me or anyone who looks like me. And that, so every single time you move through your lives, every single time you think about hiring someone or not hiring someone, every single time a person of color is sitting in front of you asking for a job, asking for advice, sitting in an interview, recognize that the work that they have done to get there and the work that they're doing in that room, in that conversation with you, is double the work that anyone who looks like you has to do. And that's it.
Yeah.
And like, that's it. Just imagine that your whole life is a shit ton harder. That's all.
Yeah. And if I can follow up on that, if the person across from you is asking for a coffee. I've gotten so much shitty service in coffee shops. People will say hi to the white person in front of me, smile. Hi to the white person in behind me, and smile.
And not know that they're doing it.
And have literally no idea. And then look at me and they're like, yeah, what can I get you? And I'm like, oof, it's not like I'm spending my money here too. This doesn't feel horrible. And so that's one thing. And then the other thing, to tack on to what Candace was saying about, I really want you to think about like how agile, Black people are so agile. When I'm selling things, and even before then, when I would be teaching people things, I have to think about what you might think about me and then think about how I'll need to mitigate that. And so, like, one of the things I used to do is, like, initially, I'd have to drop where I worked because I would see people go into places and say, oh, yeah, I work in coffee. And people are like, oh, yeah, you work in coffee, bro? What do you do? Blah, blah, blah. I say I work in coffee, and they're like, mm-hmm. So I can't just say I work in coffee like the person in front of me just did because that doesn't work if I need an opening for sales. And so then I have to drop that I worked at like two of the biggest roasters and that I know a lot of people and that I know a lot of shit. And I have to find a way to casually work into the conversation because people don't like braggy Black people or women. And so I have to like casually drop these gems so a person will take me seriously. Yeah. So we haven't even gotten to the point where I'm like talking about why I'm here or the business that I'm working on or the really cool thing that my sourcing companies are doing. Or like when I was doing account management with Counterculture, trying to tell you that, yes, I do in fact know what I'm talking about and you should take my advice on how to run your business. I couldn't just go in and do my job. I would literally have to be like, what are these people going to think about me? How do I get them to take them seriously? And how do I drop my resume strategically just to open the door to do the thing that I came here to do? And so like when like the agility. And what could I do? I'll never stop saying this. What the fuck could I do with that brain space if I didn't have to do it? So all the shit that companies get out of me and all the good work I've done, I've been doing it while also doing this other stuff. And that's wild.
And people don't want to continue doing that.
And it's exhausting, and I don't get paid more to do it either.
Mm-hmm. There should be some kind of levy.
It's been,
yeah. Really called reparations.
Oh, in England, reparations. Well, I'm from England. There ain't
I was
no
gonna say I don't.
There should be some kind of like you should be able to get paid more. Like in London, London's so expensive to live in. They have a job will the wage will be completely different in London than it is like in a neighboring city because like much like you know New York or wherever else, it's exponentially like more expensive. So they call it London waiting. There should be like Black people waiting. Should be like weighted salaries. You know, it's tiring.
And except we get paid less.
Yeah. Don't the woman tax too. What?
This makes me think about, in June I had a panel discussion, a queer coffee discussion. I'm also queer. And so I, at the time, a new blue bottle had opened up near my shop. And so I was like, oh, you know, there's a bunch of new baristas in there. I'm going to go in there and invite them because, you know, like they probably don't know who I am, blah, 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 blah. And so I went in, a couple people had helped before me, and I walked in. And I was like, oh, can I have a cortado? And the guy at the register, he said, well, we call them Gibraltars here. I was like, okay, can I have a Gibraltar? And he's like, well, you know, we use a lot of complex coffee language here. I was like, all right, just whatever. And so, funny enough, the kid goes over, and he was obviously new because he made me a terrible drink. It was a terrible shot, and the milk was too cold. And so I sat there and choked it down, and I smiled at him in a very grimacing way. And afterwards, he was... And so I went over, I saw that there were some, you know, more seasoned baristas. And I was like, hey, guys, you know, I was actually coming in. And I said it loud enough for him to hear it. I was like, I'm actually coming in because I'm actually a manager at Intelligentsia. And I'm coming in to invite you to this coffee event that I'm holding next week. And the kid who had made me the drink and was a huge asshole to me, he was like, oh, my God, you work at Intelligentsia? And I was like, yeah, I'm actually, you know, I've been in coffee and people know me around here, you know, and I just wanted to invite you to my coffee event. And he's like, oh, he was like, well, what did you think of my drink? And I was like, it was terrible. It was really bad. I'm sorry. And he was like, oh my goodness. And so the next time I came in, he was like, oh, hey, Christina, how are you? Can I make you a drink? You know, he's like, I really want to make you this new coffee, blah, 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 blah. And I was like, I literally had to not only name drop, my own name, I had to name drop Intelligentsia. And, you know, just like totally blew his mind that someone who looked like me could be like
a seasoned coffee professional. How do you think it feels to live in Australia?
You did that to yourself.
But you had to leave the country to be taken seriously.
That is another black coffee for another time. Right. Black coffee Australia. Yeah.
So it's you then.
Yeah. But I do think it's awful. Like as much as we're good about making jokes, how awful is that to need to qualify your humanity to get a good coffee and some good customer service from a person whose literal job it is to provide you those things? Like, that's the worst. And so it's like, it is, and those are like small things. And like, think about how comfortable you all feel in cafe spaces. And like that, how shitty it would feel to not always know that that's the experience that you're going to get. And I don't always go to the places with the best coffee because I don't want lukewarm customer service. Like, there's a cafe in my neighborhood that I like. Sometimes the coffee's great. Sometimes it's not so great. Usually it's right in the middle. But the people are always nice to me. So I go there and I spend my money. And while there are technically nicer cafes or in other nicer cafes in areas, different areas of the city, like, I don't go to those places because I work too hard to be treated like shit to pay my money at somebody's business. And I don't wanna, and now I don't say I work in coffee when I go to cafes because I don't want you to only treat me like a good person because I sell green coffee. You think that's cool. I want you to treat me like a human being that's deserving of service because I'm alive and I'm breathing and I'm in your coffee shop. Yeah. And so I just think that's important.
I don't mean to cut y'all off, but I gotta cut y'all off.
I'm gonna let you finish. I want to leave a little bit of time and listen to me, y'all. I'm going to look at all of you. We have time for one question and one question only. And if you saw what happened in Portland, if you're white, you're not allowed to get on this microphone. Okay? So I'll leave the one question for anyone else to come and ask about anything to these lovely people. I'm sorry, she ruined it for y'all.
Michelle.
What happened? Anybody, you can come up here and and if a white person has a good question,
we will judge if it's a good question.
You can also still come up.
Ask a black person next to you if this question is okay to ask. And then ask another one.
They will determine whether or not double it is a good question.
Yeah, any questions? It's okay if you don't have any questions.
Anyone?
If there's no questions from the crowd, can I ask you guys a question?
Sure.
Is that fine?
Yeah.
So since I'm obviously part of this discussion, I'm mixed race, black as well, but I come from a different industry, and I feel like everything that's been spoken on stage, it's slightly different, but we share some similarities backstage. And earlier you spoke, you said you addressed the white people in the crowd, asking them to do this or say this or see us in this way. And since the topic of discussion here was longevity, instead of asking the white people in the crowd, because they're not allowed to ask any questions, as black professionals, like, where do you guys see the longevity? What do you guys need to do to make this work? Because clearly, based on the discussion, there's a lot of things that white people are doing that make you feel a certain way. So as black professionals, when you take the matter in your hands, what are you guys going to do to fix this?
I can answer that. Keep being disruptive. Mm-hmm. Make everything look how I want it to look. Rule the world.
Yeah.
Silently go away.
Yeah, I think retire
to an island somewhere.
I think we're doing that, Winston. I mean, I feel like, I mean, just from Portland, I felt like there's a lot of inspiration out there for people of color to get into coffee, and they see that, oh, there is life after being a barista. I always looked at the barista position as a dead-end job, and I was out, and then I discovered competition, and through the competing, I've met so many people of color that said, you know, because you're doing what you're doing, I am able to do what I'm doing. And I think that's, I mean, I think we're a part of something bigger, and we're not going to see these immediate changes like tomorrow. We'll see them down the road.
Yeah, I think, and me and Winston being the youngest in terms of time in the industry.
The babies. Yeah.
Oh, that totally was not a backhanded. Okay, but in terms, you know, and I think about this too. Like, I hear, you know, 10 years, 15 years, 8 years, like that amount of time. To me, I mean, I've only been here for 4.5. It's like that seems like so long to have to deal with the negatives. Honestly, when I was working at this shop in Newton, I didn't see myself having a future. I was just going home and crying every night, and I was like, there's no way I could do it. And it wasn't until I started speaking out and speaking my mind that I actually felt empowered and felt like I could have a future. And just, I think for me, just like going day to day and focusing on one thing that I'm going to work on today. So, you know, I go in tomorrow, and tomorrow I'm going to work with this person on this, and tomorrow I'm going to work, you know, I'm going to like really focus in on my bar skills, or like the next day I'm going to work on this, and like trying not to have these anxieties, you know, and we all have some anxiety, I think, at one point or another, and trying to turn that negative energy into positive the best of my ability has kept me going day to day, and starting to see beyond a one time point and seeing into the future. So that for me, seeing years down the road, that is what helps me. So
I'm a big fan of miscegenation. So I've married a white guy. So every time I'm mad at white people, the monolithic group, not the autism individuals I know, I go home and scream at my husband. It's awesome. I love you, honey. In all seriousness, I think that I learned a long ago from the incredible lineage of matriarchs before me that this is my road. I don't get another road. And yes, that same white guy will tell you I moan a lot. And I can get really negative and all up in my feelings and not in a Drake way. And I'll cry. I'll cry and scream and yell and say that I'm leaving coffee. But I love coffee. And the thing that keeps me in it is learning. It is infinite. It is incredible. I think the first, I was really lucky, the first Origin trip I went on in 2012 was to Brazil with the SCAA, as it was then, for a failed venture of theirs, and I'm really glad I got onto the only annual, it's never happened since, the only annual SCA science Origin trip. And it blew my mind. And in fact, on that trip, like, we went and did a bunch of things. So I remember one of the most incredible interactions I had was with a professor at UFLA, which is the university in Minas Gerais, who do a lot of coffee experiments in situ. They have a coffee farm and they have a coffee mill at the campus. I sat down in a classroom because we were getting a talk by an incredible gentleman called Dr. Flavio Barem. And if you have any opportunity to him speak, if you buy his processing book, like, seriously, this man is insanely bright, so humble. And I sat in that class, and that man answered every single question that I had, and I had a million by this point. And he said to me, "Oh, I thought you were one of my PhD students." And I was just like, oh my God. You know, but it was the fact that, like, all it was that coffee, and all it is the coffee. And you can never know everything about coffee, and that to me is amazing. I always wanted to live in a library, because that's where I lost myself, and that's where I still lose myself, is in books. Like, working coffee is the same feeling. There's never not going to be something to read. You know, there's never not going to be something that I don't know. And it's amazing. And all of you in this room know way more things than I have any idea about. So, like, it's exciting to be in a room with all these coffee professionals, because all I'm thinking, even though I teach Q, even though I teach, like, everything else, all I'm thinking is I can learn so much from these people. So I think that's
and you're not the only one that feels that way. Mm-hmm. Obviously, we're all on stage here, and we all have made a career out of this, and there are a lot of people out there who are Black and who, you know, they love this. And so many of them never get the opportunity to actually sink their teeth in and to do, you know, take it to the next level and do something else with it. Like, I also saw Flex. I spoke at the same thing Tamika did in Norway. But what I talked about was, you know, training people to do more than just learning how to roast or learning how to be baristas. It's like, we're becoming a whole ass industry that has marketing departments and HR departments and operations. But you have to have that unique knowledge of how specialty coffee runs to be able to marry those together for your coffee business to be successful. So it's like, you know, I really enjoyed the marketing thing, but I had to teach it to myself because the marketing department at my old coffee shop sure as hell wasn't trying to hire me into it. But another black coffee for another time. Thank you all so much.
So Hard Flex is, I also spoke at that event. It's one of the most prestigious events in coffee. It's the Nordic Roasters Forum. These girls are being way too shy.
Soft Flex, I was there.
Thank you.
I do want to answer Winston's question if there's little
time. Go ahead. You can end the show.
If I can answer with Winston's question. So you all can ask me later. I won't announce it now, but I will be working at a lovely new company starting next Monday. And during my interview, they asked me, like, one of many interviews, they asked me, what kind of person, like, in a group, what person are you? Like, if you had to describe yourself. Are you, like, the coach, you the motivator, whatever? And I said I was the hold people accountable-er. And they said it was the first time they heard it, but it's true. And so, like, to answer your question is, like, what I intend to do as, like, a black coffee professional to keep our industry moving forward in the direction that I'd like it to go in. I'm going to use the things that I do well, which is to communicate with people and to be vulnerable about my experiences, because I do think vulnerability is a very underused way to reach people and reach them in a real way that moves them into wanting to do things differently. And like, that's what I'm choosing to do as a black person, even though it's an additional burden. It's a labor of love, one I wish I didn't have to do, but I will do for as long as I have to. But also, the responsibility doesn't lie with us to do it, because we're the statistical minority. So it's like, if the reality is, on this end of the supply chain, if that's going to change,
we need companies, we need people with capital to commit to these things and to take them seriously. And so I'm going to keep talking about it and doing my part. And I'm also going to hold companies accountable to do what they say they're going to do, to push them forward, to create environments where Black people can succeed, environments where, especially in retail environments, where they acknowledge that racism is a real fucking thing. And so some of your customers are going to be racist, and some of your staff are going to have to deal with racism. And if you can't, you can't even create an environment for a Black person if you can't acknowledge that racism is real, and you can't acknowledge that Black people are going to be dealing with racism in a way that makes their job hard. Like, you're incapable of creating a healthy space for a Black person if you can't do that. And so I'm just going to keep holding companies accountable and communicating really clearly about the ways in which they're failing us. And I'm just, that's my part, just to hold people accountable and make them do the right thing.
I'm going to keep putting all y'all in the room together. Because that's, Dee has said it multiple times, the best and worst thing that's ever happened is Coffee letting all of us get together, because we have been scheming on the low. But on that note, I want to thank each and every one of you so much for being a part of this. I really appreciate it. I want to thank you all for coming.
Thank you.
That is Black Coffee New York. Thank you. Goodbye. Reel it in, I got the bag. Tell a friend, she got some ass. Bring it in, bitch, I'm the new CNN. Yeah. Reel it in, I got the bag. Tell a friend, she got some ass. Bring it in, bitch, I'm the new CNN. Yeah. Hey. Drippin', really got the TikTok missin'. It's pimpin', broke niggas got me livin'. Wow. You Jordan a Pippin', I'm Kobe, I'm never gon' dish it. Or miss it. I'm dissin' as fuck and I ain't got the time to just kick it. I don't trust nobody cause I can't be fake.